You're watching the free version of SynthEyes Essentials. For projects and footage, head to BorisFX.com for the premium download. Hey, welcome back to the wonderful world of match moving in SynthEyes. In the last class, we learned how we can turn raw tracking data, so-called blips, into trackers for SynthEyes. In this class, I want us to take these trackers and turn them into an actual solved camera. Before we head to the solver room, let's make a very quick stop in the trackers room. We will spend a lot more time here in the next class. For now, I just want to show you one thing. Click on any of these trackers and watch the values here on the left. You see two values changing. This is the movement of the tracker on the horizontal and vertical axes. Nothing is happening in regards to depth or rotation. That is to be expected, as these guys, for now, are simple point trackers. The magic will happen once we go into the solver room. Like in the summary room, we've got a big green button. This time it's labeled Go. As with all big buttons, there is this internal urge to just push it. We will do that in a second. Just quickly take a look at the views here in the solver room. Our camera in the top three views is locked, not moving at all. The only thing moving are those 2D trackers. Okay. Now we can hit go. And a couple of things happened here. A pop-up showed up and probably very quickly went through a couple of steps. In a nutshell, SynthEyes was taking a look whether any constraints were put into our scene, like us defining a size for an object, an origin point, or something similar. Then it searched for the best frames to start solving the shot, added information as needed, and then went through a couple of iterations to come up with a solve. And quite a high error value. We will talk about this error value in a bit, but there's more. In the windows of the solver room, there are now quite some points, and if we shuttle through our scene, we see the camera moving around in a way that actually resembles what I did when I filmed that scene. This is really important. Your initial solve doesn't need to be perfect, but it should be sensible. The scene may not be orientated correctly, the camera path might be a little jittery or a little off, but it should at least come close to what you would expect the real camera to be moving like. If this wasn't the case, then there's something fundamentally wrong with the data we are supplying, and we should either add or delete trackers to give a better base for solving the shot. In a case like that, all the next steps will probably make your solve worse and not better. To understand why that is the case, we need to take a look at this HPIX value. HPIX stands for horizontal pixel. That on itself will not tell us that much, but at the beginning of the class we took a look at the 2D tracker data in the tracker room. These 2D trackers are represented by the green rectangles. Each tracker was moving on the horizontal and vertical axes. Now that SynthEyes has got a camera that is moving, it projects the position of each tracker into 3D space, symbolized by the yellow crosses. So these 3D points are not moving, the camera is. SynthEyes is now comparing how much these 2D trackers deviate from the solved 3D points on the horizontal axis in pixels. That is why it's called the HPIX error, horizontal pixel error. Actually, we see that HPIX value in three places in the solver room. Up here, right below the green Go button, then on the right, at the end of that initial solver summary, and then last but not least, down here in the error curve mini view. Now this HPIX value is not for a specific tracker, but rather an average of the dozens of trackers that we've got in our scene. In most cases, you want that HPIX value to be below 1. That means that, on average, your solved camera never deviates more than 1 pixel from the individual trackers. In theory, that should mean that your solve is rock solid, but there are exceptions to that rule. You can also examine the HPIX error for individual trackers, if you select a single tracker. The error curve mini view will change and show you the HPIX for that single tracker. If that HPIX error down here now seems ridiculously high, don't worry. In this mode, SynthEyes will not show you the average error value, but the maximum. And this also works not only for a single, but also a selection of trackers. So if we lasso select those 5 trackers, we get a maximum HPIX error for those 5 trackers shown in your error curve mini view. Another method you can use is to just hover over a tracker you want to examine. A little pop-up will give you both 2D and 3D coordinates for that point as well as its individual HPIX value. By now you should realize why it is so important to verify that this initial solve is sensible. If it wasn't, then SynthEyes would compare good trackers to a wacky solve, and this value, which will be our guide in getting our solve across the finish line, would be meaningless. Of all the three places you see the HPIX error, the error curve mini view is by far the most useful, as it gives you a representation of the error value across time. You can see that if you shuttle along, a little playhead moves along the error curve mini view as well. And the color gives you a great indication where there are still problems. So if something is green, that means the error is below 1. Yellow means the error value is between 1 and 2, and red means it is above 2. So our aim is a totally green curve. How do we achieve that? Let me introduce you to another great tool for analyzing our solve, which is the tracker radar. You can switch it on if you right-click and then go to View, Tracker Radar. The tracker radar is really easy. The bigger the circle around your tracker, the higher the HPIX error. And we can notice one thing about our radar. A lot of the errors get higher the closer we get to the edge of the frame. Now, what could possibly cause a bigger difference between a 2D tracker and a solved virtual camera towards the edge of the frame? Exactly, lens distortion. So this should be our first step. So let's click the checkbox for calculate distortion. Let's change our solve mode to refine and hit go. Granted, it's not a big jump in our error value, but it is down a bit. Let's see how we can improve our track even more. We already opened the cleanup trackers dialog in class number 1. Let's do so again, but this time we are not going to blindly fire away, but take a close look instead at what the cleanup trackers dialog is doing. Once again, we can open up the cleanup tracker dialog two ways, either by going up to the menu, track, cleanup trackers, or by hitting Shift C on our keyboard. Let's start at the top. Right now our selection is set to auto only, and the 0 in brackets tells us that no trackers are selected. That is because when we chose our trackers in the last class and set them to golden, we converted our auto trackers to manual trackers. So let's go with all trackers. Below that, we can click a checkbox for bad trackers. That will select trackers that have a particularly high HPIX error and either disable or delete the range where they are bad. The current default setting is that the top 2% of trackers with a high HPIX will be deleted, but we can also define a custom threshold in either percent or HPIX. If we press show and then select, SynthEyes will show us all the trackers in red that will be affected. But that is only partially helpful, as we don't see at what moment in time they will be affected. If we press unlock UI, we can change our layout to the graph editor. We are going to switch to tracks mode, which will let us get rid of all those graph curves. Let's also press this button down here to squish all trackers into view. In our cleanup trackers dialog, we can now once again lock the UI to access the controls. And now we actually see what kind of trackers would be affected at what time if we press fix. But let's hold on that for a second. We don't have any very far trackers or short-lived trackers in this particular shot, but we do have some high error trackers. That means trackers where more than 30% of the track have got a high error. Let's keep those selected as well. Last but not least, there is clear all blips selected by default. Let's uncheck that. Keeping the blips in your script can add a couple of megabytes to your script size, but in some cases we will still need the blips. With that selection, we can now press fix. In our graph view, we can see that the cleanup trackers dialog actually deleted and curtailed quite a lot of trackers. Our error rate is still too high, but that will be fixed if we refine our scene based on the new tracker data. Let's switch our layout back to the solver output view and then hit go. And boom, our error is well below 1. Or is it? The number below the go button is, but our error curve shows a much higher value. Which one is correct? Don't panic, we did a good job on cleaning up the trackers. The issue is that with this process we still have all trackers selected, and if that is the case, then the error curve mini view shows us the maximum for all trackers selected, not the average like above. Just left click anywhere but a tracker in any of the 3D views just to deselect all the trackers. And we can see that our curve is almost totally green now. We could try another tracker cleanup run to get rid of the last few spikes, but I want us to take a more subtle approach. Our tracker radar is still active, so let's take a look at the trackers with the highest error peaks in the radar, the biggest circles. This tracker here, for example, has got a high error at the very beginning, but after that it consistently supplies very good data, So we definitely don't want to delete it. We just want to tell SynthEyes to maybe not use the very first few frames. Head on back to the trackers room. With our tracker still selected, we can now use the little padlock here to unlock it. Then, below this little detail view, we do have two very important controls, the arrow and the traffic light. The traffic light will disable the tracker from the frame you are on, and the arrow will determine whether you disable everything from the moment in time onwards or up until that point. As we want to disable the first few frames, we should change the direction by clicking on the arrow. And then, click the traffic light and keep an eye on the arrow curve mini view. So the first 15 frames of that tracker will not be considered when we do another solve or refinement, but only if we close the padlock again. Open trackers will be ignored completely, so keep that in mind. So now we will repeat this process for a couple more trackers. If there's one like this, where the whole arrow curve is either yellow or red, we can delete it wholesale by pressing the delete key on our keyboard. This may not be as fast as the cleanup trackers dialog, but it gives you granular control on what trackers supply which information to the solver. Going back to the solver room, we can refine once more. Our average HPIX error is not that much lower, but the spikes are gone for good now. Well done. Let's finish this class with aligning the scene, but this time we're not going to be using the *3 method. If we take a look in our quad perspective view, we can see that we are almost aligned. Once again, check if you see something in the perspective viewer. If not, hover over it with a mouse and hit L on your keyboard. If you want to adjust the size of the chisels in the perspective view, just head on over to Edit, Edit Scene Settings, and up here, you can change the tracker size. The scene is just hovering a little bit above the ground plane. Switch over to the 3D room, where we created our earthling in the first class. This is the perfect opportunity to highlight a little peculiar behavior of the rooms, but this behavior can be really helpful. If you click on the name of the room, it'll change the layout to a default associated with that room. That means for the 3D room, it would have the quad view as a default. That could work for us, but I would love to have the ground plane visible, like I do right now with my quad perspective view. If you don't want the layout to change when switching rooms, just tap the icon left to the room name and you will change rooms while keeping the layout. On the left-hand side, we've got controls for translation, rotation, and scale. Let's start with translation. As we want to move the whole scene, just activate Whole, and then you can either use the front or left view to bring the whole scene down. We will jump a bit between rotation and translation for further fine-tuning. If you use rotation, you'll find that the rotation always centers around the point in space where you are clicking and then dragging. That way you can align the scene manually and already familiarize yourself with the 3D controls. Once you're done, treat yourself by placing an earthling here at the end of that walkway. The tracker number gives you additional guidance on where to place your earthling. This tracker looks really good. Once again, this was really a packed class. We learned about how to solve moving 2D trackers into a moving 3D camera. Understanding the way SynthEyes compares the solved points to the original 2D trackers was also a really important step. We then learned how to use automatic and manual processes to bring this error value below 1 to achieve a rock solid track. And we learned how to align our scene using the manual controls in the 3D room. Well done. So give yourself a little break, and I will see you in the next class.